All right, guys, what's going on? We got another exciting show for you today. We got Jimmy Vandanacker here today. He is a two-time cancer survivor, and his seven-year-old daughter's fighting cancer, too.
Let me tell you something you already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows.
You got to keep moving. Let's keep moving. Let's go. Don't quit till you got nothing left.
You can either live your dreams or live your fears.
Because you'll have bad times. But that'll always wake you up to the good stuff you weren't paying attention to.
But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done.
From the Cancer Sucks Studios, you just tuned in to Life Lessons and Cancer Hope with Coach Steve. Listen, cancer ain't got nothing on me. Introducing an outstanding podcast where we discuss relatable life lessons, ambition, motivation, and perseverance. Welcome back to another episode.
Jimmy, thanks for being on this episode today, podcast, to talk about your story. And so thanks again.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, Steve. Yeah, we've had some fun little interactions here for a little while, so it's finally nice to meet up and get this underway.
Yeah, absolutely. So, we'll start with you being two-time different cancers, unrelated. Talk about what was going on when you first got diagnosed with the first one. And
my first cancer. So it was embryonal carcinoma, stage four. It was kind of interesting how that came about. You know, like a lot of things, you know, it's symptomatic at first and you don't really know what it is until you go get a scan or a blood test, and then definitively you'll be able to tell. I had just tremendous back pain for quite a while. I would say maybe a year, almost a year. And, you know, being 21 years old, in my head, I'm attributing it to, okay, it could be that snowboarding accident. I worked construction hard for years. It could be, you know, a number of things. So, but it was so bad, my lower back, it just felt like it was in a vice constantly. And I'd be like sleeping on the floor in front of one of those baseboard heaters just to get the heat to relax the muscles. And yeah, it's just a tremendous amount of pain. And then I actually went and visited my parents, and I was staying the night over there. And the pain was so bad that it would keep me up at night. Like sometimes I just wouldn't sleep at all. I'd be sitting up in my bed, just like watching TV until the sun came up. I mean, it was really that bad. So, my girlfriend, I went and visited my parents, and that night, typical what it had been, back pain. I was sitting up in bed, and it was about 4 o'clock in the morning when I finally fell asleep. And I literally fell asleep like sitting up. I was just kind of going like this. I woke up 4 hours later at 8 o'clock, and I was like, oh man, my neck is killing me. And I go to feel my neck, as you can see this nice scar right here. I go to feel my neck, and this is like something like a palm. It's like a half of a lime, like out of nowhere, in 4 hours from nothing to something like substantial. And so I was like, waking up my girlfriend going, oh my, what'd I do? And I like pull a muscle, what's going on here? And, we tried massaging it all day, icing it. It went into the hot tub, ice cold, hot, whatever it was. And it was just getting really bad and becoming more pronounced throughout the day. So we went down to a local hospital in Bremerton, Washington. I live on the other outside Puget Sound, outside Seattle. But they went down to the hospital there. It's a pretty significant hospital because they're by a military installation there. And the scans came back, and I'll just never forget like what the doctor said. So he's walking towards us with a clipboard, and I have my father on, I think it was my left side, and my girlfriend's on my right side. And he looks up at me, and the first words, no kidding, like out of his mouth, is that he goes, "I'm scared for you."
Oh no.
And I'm like, okay.
Poor choice of words.
Yeah. I'm like, your bedside manner is terrible. So, well, what's going on? And so he said, so your scans came back, and he said, it looks like you have about 16 plus tumors, mostly along your spinal cord. They're in your neck, your chest, your stomach, your abdomen, kind of everywhere. And so it appears to be, a metastasized stage 4 cancer. We're going to have to run some more tests to see, what's going on. And so it's, shock, right? It's one of the, first times I've ever seen my dad cry, like in my life. So, that was a pretty big shock to the system. So yeah, through further diagnosis, they said that, it's embryonal carcinoma, germ cell cancer. The statistics were showing that I had roughly 14% chance of survival. And they considered it terminal. They're like, you have about 45 days to live. And I was I'm like, I disagree with you.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So they said that there's any chance of surviving, we got to get this going ASAP. So within like 36 hours, I think I was doing chemo like right away. And I went around back over to the Seattle side to Swedish Hospital. And Swedish is absolutely amazing in Seattle. I mean, it's one of the world cancer centers. It's absolutely amazing. So people travel from all the world to go there, and there's a definite reason why. So, but that's where I did most of my treatment. No, all my treatment was there with a doctor, Henry Kaplan over there, who's just recently retired, but him and his team, I owe my life to. Those guys were amazing.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So how long were you fighting that until it was totally gone?
That was 2005 to 2006. So,
okay.
Yeah. So with the most of it was like a September to March. So, it did come back in where we're heading towards March, where we thought the chemotherapy had, raisined up all the tumors and, we're getting rid of it. But then like a couple of weeks passed by, and, it only takes one cell, right? So it started coming back even more aggressive out of the scar tissue. So they're like, we got to get that scar tissue out of you. And remember, this is tumors everywhere, right?
Yeah.
So mostly on my spinal cord. So they're like, this is a significant surgery. My oncologist called through his Rolodex all over the nation. And there's only one guy that it's like his expertise to do this type of surgery, where they had to take all of my organs out of me, every single one of them, carve up all the scar tissue, put me all back together. And he was in Indianapolis. So I was on a plane heading out there within a couple of weeks. And
how many surgeons did he end up? Just the one operating on you? Did he have like a team?
He had a whole team, but he's the main surgeon. He's actually Lance Armstrong's surgeon. So,
oh, wow. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's funny. So I remember I was getting wheeled into the room, and the guy had a really good personality about him too. And he said, yeah, one of the last times I did surgeries like this, was when Lance Armstrong and a couple other folks. And he said, it's really funny. I was wheeling Lance in, and we're doing a surgery for him. And Lance, probably a pretty arrogant guy. Sure. He looks up at him and says, you better be half as good of a surgeon as I am a bike rider. And he looked down at Lance and said, you better shut your mouth and never be riding a bike again. So, after that,
how many hours were you in the surgery? Geez. You remember? You must have been in there a long time.
I can't remember. I have to ask my wife. It was probably 10 hours.
Yeah. I was going to say, it's gotta be double digits.
Yeah. Yeah. At least. So, Yeah. So yeah, it's quite the experience. And yeah, I have a ton of story. I tell stories all the time to people about, you know, everything. And, you know, fighting through something like that, there's so much of it's mental.
And yeah, I was going to ask you, like, what kind of mental or lifestyle changes you did to help you fight the cancer?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a jokester at heart, so I'm always messing with my nurses and making the light of situations. So I had, through that treatment, three main chemos. It was etoposide, cisplatin, and bleomycin. Now, the bleomycin in 2005 was new. It wasn't new, but it was like approved new. Like, it's gone through the trials, everything. And my oncologist said, look, bleomycin's chosen, or it's been proven to really fight this type of cancer just with amazing results. However, it does have a significant side effect. Obviously, you're an athlete. He's like, if you choose to go forward with it, it does have an adverse effect on your lungs. So it can kind of put them into a, essentially kind of rigor mortis, where they won't want to expand or contract. They kind of seize up a little bit, and you'll be able to have some scar tissue inside your lungs. And it kind of results in pulmonary fibrosis. And I said, look, if that's the best chance I have for survival, then let's do it.
Yeah.
So we ended up doing it, and it was the best decision. Coincidentally, there was one gentleman who was a year younger than me, and he was some type of athlete as well. And he chose not to do it because of the adverse effect on his lungs. And he wasn't as bad off as I was, as far as the stage he was at with the same type of cancer. And unfortunately, he didn't make it.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, and same hospital, same treatment, everything, but he just chose not to do the bleomycin. So yeah, it was a really interesting analysis.
Do you feel any, like, does that affect you today, or do you think it's mostly resolved, the lungs?
Mostly. I've done tons of pulmonary testing. My stats were at 40% of lung capacity afterwards. Oh, wow. So I had really shallow breaths. But I mean, as soon as I could get back on my feet, I've been a soccer player my whole life. So I started playing soccer immediately. And so within a year, I worked it back up to like, you know, 65%. And then following couple of years after that, I eventually got it to, I think, 85% or so. And I think that's kind of where it stands today. And wow. I'm just used to it at this point.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. All right. And you just said, you know, you're, you know, try to be funny guy. But as far as like mental, or did you do any diet changes during during your cancer treatment?
I was losing so much weight. I was actually just going for high calorie, low sugar.
So you're just eating it. Yeah. Just to get it in, right?
I mean, tumors. Yeah, I was doing that too in the beginning. Tumors. I mean, think of, you know, you kind of are what you eat, right? And it's, too much sugar is bad for you, you know, as your parents always tell you. Well, it is true. Sure. I mean, so my oncologist, like, honestly, just stay away from sugar, eat as many calories as you can, which is good advice, because I couldn't eat that much. I just wasn't hungry. And as you know, I mean, when you go through chemo and surgery and stuff, you don't want to eat. So I had to just force myself to eat, but I got down to 150 or 155 pounds, which is 100 pounds less than I am today.
Oh, wow. Holy cow. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. You lost. Holy cow. You're a ton. Well, you got back, and, you know, for those in the audience, I'll put your Instagram up, but Jimmy is a bodybuilder, weightlifter. So do you attribute a lot to your first cancer success, not just for the direction of the meds that you went to, but obviously exercise, because you were already in shape, right? And you were already working out on a regular basis.
Yeah, it actually, I can narrow it down to one sentence. So when everything was done throughout that entire cancer, the first cancer ordeal, my oncologist said it very, very simply. He said, and I quote, he said, if you were not in such good a shape going into this, you would have not survived.
Wow.
So that is luck, in my head. So I just kind of had this, you know, it's kind of become a catalyst of like kind of how I view life, is that I need to be as strong as I can be for whenever I need to be that way. And, you know, being a father of triplets and, you know, I have responsibilities, like I want to be strong. I want to live as long as possible because that I have a lot to live for.
Yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. I'm all geared up, man. I didn't work out yet today, but after this podcast this afternoon, I'm going to head out to the gym, hit some weights, man. Yeah. That's definitely some motivation right there. Wow. And so then, so you were in remission after the second time. On your first, or no evidence of disease, on your first cancer. Oh, what year was this that you were all done with it?
So I was done with my first cancer in 2006.
Okay.
And so how I got to my second type of cancer. So I had like a clean bill of health. I mean, I was healthy. I felt good, everything. And then, but I, because of my cancer and my history, I was blacklisted from life insurance for a decade.
Oh, sure. Like
I couldn't get it. And if I could get it, I probably didn't want to pay for it, right? So they said after 10 years, then you can go apply for life insurance again. I'm like, sweet. So 2016 hits, and I'm like, okay. And so I told my wife, I'm like, all right, I'm going to go do my blood tests, get life insurance, because my kids are like 2 years old at that point. And so I go do my blood tests, and then my blood comes back, and there's cancer markers in them. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding. You got to be kidding me.
And unrelated, right? This is like a totally, this isn't Matt's. This is a totally.
Yeah. It's so close in lineage of like the type of cancer with embryonal carcinoma. But it being germ cell, it is kind of reproductive organ centric, but he said this is unrelated because it's not a germ cell. It's just flat out unfortunate. So I said, like, dude, do we catch it early? Because I'd been doing my tests. I wasn't, you know, Johnny on the spot with all my tests. I'd, you know, less a month slide before I went in, but I wasn't too far out. But he said, no, it's early. So ended up having my left testicle removed, and they said, but with the type of cancer it is, like, we do have to do one large dose, like a super dose of chemo. It's just one big hit with carboplatin. Okay. And he said, look, Jimmy, like, I know you went through all your stage four cancer, all of your chemo. I didn't vomit one time ever throughout my entire cancer stint. But he did say, he goes, this carboplatin though, this like super dose, you'll be fine for like 5 days. And I think this was on like a Tuesday. Yeah, I think it was like a Tuesday. And he said, when Sunday comes around, it's going to feel like you hit by a truck. And me, I'm like, yeah, okay. Yeah, sure.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, no. Yeah,
right. Sure. Yeah. Right. So yeah, Saturday was fine. And then I woke up Sunday morning. Oh my gosh.
Oh, sure.
That chemo, obviously it works, but what it did to me is that it produced so much stomach acid, like it just, that I was vomiting straight up acid constantly. But what made it worse is that it also caused muscle spasms. So I was spasming and vomiting.
Oh, that must have been awful. Awful.
Constantly. So like 3 days of that go by doing and I was trying every single medication possible, and like everything that they were prescribing, from muscle relaxers to antacids to, I mean, you name it. And I've never been real big into like the cannabis and everything. But one of my friends who's medicinally, that's his specialty. And he's like, Jimmy, I'm coming over. I'm going to give you some CBD pills. He's like, trust me. And I was like, at this point, I don't care if it's snake oil. I'll take it.
Yeah.
So he came over and he gave me these pills, and I took two of them, and it was CBD. I don't know the specifics of it, but it literally stopped the convulsions. It lowered the stomach acid. And then for the first time in like 3 days, I stopped doing it. It like stopped in its tracks for the side effects. And I was like, that's great. Dude, what are these magic pills you hit me? So yeah, it's pretty amazing.
Oh yeah. I actually do finally got my medical marijuana card because here in New York, you know, it's we don't have any like open distributors, although they say it's legal now in New York, but it's not. They still have to, you know, go through some stuff. But.
Yeah. Hey, I've been there in Seattle, being through there's like phases to it where it's like legalized, but not socially acceptable. So there was kind of fighting against the grain. Within 3 months, it'll be just like here, probably.
Yeah. I mean, I was trying all kinds of different medications from palliative care to, you know, I just had a recent psychiatrist recommend stuff, like basically said, you know what, stick to the CBD THC stuff because the liver and the enzymes and being up, he's not surprised that some of these other, prescription medications, you know, for, there was like anxiety, depression, you know, stomach stuff, all kinds of stuff I was taking. And I just had to keep switching medications because either it wasn't working or it was like, I was like, I don't know, the 3% population of having these side effects that are very rare. And, so they finally said, you know, hey, you know, maybe, you know, stick with that natural, stuff. And, it's been doing pretty good. You know, it's been helping, you know, with the anxiety and you know, stomach, every time my stomach, I get stomach rot or whatever, I'll take the tincture underneath my tongue. You know, I'm not smoking here like Snoop Dogg, but you know, I just do a little tincture, but yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. For some reason. And, I was kind of in the similar group, that the tincture actually doesn't work for me. I don't metabolize it correctly with the tincture, whether I drink it or under my tongue or something. And I tried, I mean, I went like 8 times over what you're supposed to take and it's nothing. And my buddy's just like, you're just one of those, you know, small percentage. He's like, but try these pills, and the pills did it, but it was like the same stuff though. It was just the way it enters your body and how you metabolize it. So yeah, it's pretty crazy. Everybody's unique.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah. So then, you went through that and then you had the surgery after, or did the chemo, was the chemo after that one
surgery before and then chemo like immediately? I think it was like even the next day, like right afterwards.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
All right. And then you were pretty much, when was the clear scans for that one then? And that was 2016.
Yeah, that's 2016. And that was pretty cut and dry. It was an exact mass. It was solidified. And the really interesting thing is that with testicular cancer, a lot of times you'll notice an additional growth or swelling or, you know, pain or something. I had zero symptoms. And I was like, that's weird. I have testicular cancer. I had no symptoms. I mean, I'm talking.
Yeah, you were just doing your 10-year test for the life insurance, right? Or whatever you were trying to do. Yeah.
Yeah. So I said, so what's the deal with it? And so the nurse, which that's actually really funny because the gal who was doing it was actually a friend of mine who did the blood test. And she's actually a pretty good friend of ours. And she's like, I'm not going to do the ultrasound for your testicular ultrasound. No, I'm like, unless you want to. But the supervisor came in and did it, and her supervisor said, so the type of testicular cancer you have, it's like a consuming type of cancer. So it doesn't produce an additional growth. It actually just consumes the existing tissue. So she's like, think of it as like cancer eclipsing your testicle. Like it's just turning it dark. It's just turning it into cancer, but there's no additional growths or swellings or anything like that. So it's like, you would never know. I was like, wow, that's kind of silent round killer.
Yeah. Silent killer right there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know for those listening out there, I did a podcast with Matt Odey, and you guys check that out. He fought testicular cancer, and man, he ended up going through, like, you know, his heart stopped. He was in ICU, I think, for a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. He just had so many complications from testicular cancer. He ended up having all these abdominal muscles removed, and Oh, he got so, I think he was down 100 pounds. He's a personal trainer too, or he was. Now he's more of a motivational speaker because of his experience. But at the time he was, you know, working out like us, you know, personal trainer. But he dropped down, I think he was like, you know, he wasn't like a huge 200-pound guy, but I think he was high 100s.
Yeah.
Man, I think he dropped down 100 pounds or something like that. He said 110 pounds. I don't know.
Crazy. Yeah. Yeah, it's in that area, there's a lot of major arteries and nerves and stuff. So on the inside of my left thigh is like numb, like to the touch. But that's like the most adverse effect I had. So I was like, that's it. I don't care.
Yeah. Wow. All right. And then now we fast forward. You have triplets.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you want to talk about your 7-year-old daughter now.
Yeah. Yeah. So our triplets, we have identical girls and a boy. We have a fraternal boy. Okay. So, and you know, when before I went through chemotherapy on my very first cancer occurrence, they said definitively, they're like, hey, look, we're gonna give you so much chemo that you won't be able to have a kid. It's fought out. So go do sperm deposits for the future if you ever want to have kids. So I did that. And so we had to do in vitro, you know, when we're ready to have kids. And apparently her stuff, my stuff is like a really good mix because, I mean, they said we had, it was something crazy, like 36 of the highest grade embryos that you could possibly get. Like, we're just hoping for one. And they're like, no, like we have quite the challenge of it getting like the highest grade when they're all like amazing. So they picked them correctly. So they said the best chance of having one kid is put in two eggs. So two fertilized eggs. So okay. So they put in two, and hopefully that we'd have, you know, one would take. And so we went in for our first ultrasound after like the blood tests came back, hormones were, you know, positive that you're pregnant. It took, you know, we'll see what's going on. So that very first ultrasound was, you know, pretty amazing where they said, well, you know, we were all getting our hopes up that, you know, if there's two in there, maybe we'll have twins. And so we're getting in our head. We're like, oh, a boy and a girl would be great. And, you know, we're getting all excited about it. And so we're doing the scan and we don't know what we're looking at here. There's, you know, what they're scanning. I can't make heads or tails of what's on the screen. And so the nurse goes, well, I know you guys had your hopes up for twins, but you're not having twins. And so we kind of look at each other and we're just like, oh, wow, that was a nice thought. And then she goes, you're having triplets. And we're like, what? And, yeah. And my mother-in-law, she was in the room and she like just levitated off the seat. She's like, yes. Sure. So yeah, it was a cool experience. So yeah, they're 7 years old now. Peyton. So there's Haley, Peyton, which are the identical girls, and they're all identical. Like we had to paint one of their toenails when they were newborns because you couldn't tell them apart. Like they're exactly.
Oh man.
And then Jackson, my boy. You know, with everything I've gone through, you know, your greatest fear as a parent is something happens to your kids. So, you know, always have the back of our head, you know, hopefully, you know, the pregnancy works out. It did. The kids are healthy. They are. And then, in 2019, around this time, actually, almost exactly, we were noticing that one of our daughters, Peyton, had, her lymph nodes were getting really swollen, like, and not just in her neck, but I was noticing like down in her arm and inside her thighs by her hips. Like there's something of significance going on with her lymph node system. And so because of my experience and, you know, my wife's been through it with me, we immediately think, oh crap, you know, maybe, you know, something cancer, maybe it's a lymphoma or something. We don't know. So we went to the hospital and, God, poor Peyton, her face was just like, her neck was just losing all the lines and it was so swollen. It was huge. And they said that, oh, it looks like she has mono and that's what's causing the inflammation. And I said, I mean, you're the doctors, but it just doesn't seem like it'd be mono. Like she doesn't have any other symptoms of mono. It's just this lymph node swelling. We went into the hospital probably, I think, 7 times. And keep in mind, since our very first visit, my wife and I both asked them, to check her blood, do a biopsy if they have to for a cancer. We just had this feeling that, it was something in the pit of your stomach, right? And they're like, no, it's all of our tests, all of our theories, everything's pointing towards like something like mono or something like that. And so we were getting anywhere with the hospital. So eventually we go to our pediatrician. We're like, look, you can obviously tell now at this point, Peyton is so swollen. She does not even look like the same person. So our pediatrician, she's like, I will get the test done. So she's like, she calls the hospital where we're getting all the cancer work done, or trying to anyway. And she talked to the oncology team, like, look, you need to take a biopsy. You need to run these tests because obviously you guys are missing something. This is not mono. So they go into one of her largest lymph nodes that was swollen in her neck, and they took a biopsy. And what do you know? It came back as they're like, well, yeah, it's cancerous. It could be lymphoma, leukemia, we'll see. And so it ended up being leukemia. Wow. So and it's not just like B cell, which is the most typical leukemia. It's MPAL, which is a mixed phenotype. So unfortunately, it's kind of you don't want. But it's a little harder to treat. But I mean, she's got my genes, good or bad, whatever you want to call it. But with all of her chemo treatments and her procedures that she's had, she is just way ahead of the curve. She's been killing it for, gosh, about two years.
That's good.
Yeah. So she should be done with her treatment in April.
Oh, yeah. Good. Nice.
Yeah. Yeah. She's a fighter. She's amazing. She doesn't complain about anything.
That's good.
Her biggest thing, the thing that she didn't like the most so far is losing her hair. Because, she has an identical sister. So who has her hair and everything. And, my son, he's such a sweethearted kid. He's like, shave my head. So we have this picture of her, like, shaving his head and stuff. So many things. It really kind of gets to me as a father, as a parent. When her hair started coming back, this was like maybe 2 months ago, she was really excited about it, but she, still didn't feel like herself. I think it was like 3 months ago. And then just within the last month, she came downstairs one day and it's now long enough where you can pull it back into a pony, like a little tiny ponytail or something. And she said, gets to me. She goes, She goes, I finally feel pretty.
That's awesome. Yeah. Little wins like that does huge amounts to the mind,
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. But, then, gosh, that happened. But what else happened? COVID, right? Like, so we're. One of our reports, right? So we're like, okay, so this is all happening. They're not going to school. We had to pull them from soccer. So they're really now living in a bubble at the house because, we don't know what COVID was doing, how it affects. There's no data on cancer. All we knew at the time was like, it's not really affecting kids, but what about kids with cancer? And, luckily, fortunately, the way COVID works is she was actually pretty safe from it because she lacks the white blood cells because of the way leukemia works and how her steroids all suppress her white blood cells. There's no white blood cells for COVID to attack. So she's actually was in a really good spot to not have COVID. But now it's a new variant. It's a little different, but I was like, look, if we're going to be locked down here at the house, let's make the house a little more fun. So I transformed my backyard. I cleared it out, built this huge playground and everything. So they,
Wow. Does she, now how do you guys, you know, cause you, you know, you know, from being both ends, so having cancer, fighting cancer yourself, and then now being a caregiver of a, you know, family member, you know, your child, you know, with cancer. So, you know, and, yeah, that's gotta be tough. Cause I, you know, my, what my wife, you know, she's my care, you know, giver. She's everything. She's my rock to me, but, I have no idea what it's like to be a caregiver, and it's very, very tough, I'm sure.
Yeah.
I know it is, but, you know, for you to be, to know both ends, that's, you know, that's
yeah. It's me knowing both ends within my wife. She's my caregiver, and then me going through it, and now our daughter's going through it. And you know, when I was going through all, like, smack dab in the middle, like my chemo and everything, my first time around, remember my dad was with me in the hospital, and I looked at him and I was like, if I survive this, which I will, he's like, I'm gonna marry that girl. My dad's like, if you don't, you're an idiot. She's I owe so much to my wife. She's absolutely, she's the rock of the family. She's incredible. So but as a parent, you know, you want to coach your kids and, you know, in soccer, and, you know, be their biggest advocate for, you know, school and everything. You want to coach them other things in life. You don't really want to coach them through cancer. But if anything, my experience has, you know, christened me for, it's to do this. So we have some pretty unique conversations. You know, she was diagnosed, you know, 2 years ago. And so she's like 5 years old. And some of the conversations we have are just like mind blowing. You know, she's pretty excited to have, you know, the same port scar that I have. Like, oh yeah, we have the scar. We're cool.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's been, you know, a kind of blessing in disguise that, you know, coaching her through this stuff. I have a different way of looking at things, where my wife is total doomsday. Like, she thinks the worst and everything. And, you know, if we have some type of complication, which we haven't had too many, we've only had one really, but I'm always glass half full. I'm like, be fine. Don't worry about it. This is, it's just kind of how I'm built.
Yeah. I mean, the mind's powerful. You know, you tell your mind that, or your mind tells yourself, your body, you know, you're, you know, look at it differently. You know, if you look at it doomsday, your body's going to shut down. But if you're like, no, you know, we could do this. Yeah. So what do you do? So besides just doing the, you know, the chemo, just do the conservative stuff with your daughter. What kind of other things do you, cause you know, kids are pretty resilient, but I mean, it's, I can't even imagine how hard it is for her, but what kind of things do you, lifestyle or mental things that you do to keep your daughter going?
You know, so my wife and I, once again, we're very different in how we kind of approach things, where, you know, she's always so concerned that she's always asking her how she's doing specifically, and, you know, trying to do unique things for her. I'm the opposite. I treat her like the other two. You know, I'll yell at her, clean up her room just as the other two. But
Well, that's probably important too, you know, to treat her as a normal kid.
Yeah. Yeah, because honestly, even at this point, she's recovered so well, and she's just, you know, being resilient through her chemo right now. And we just doubled her chemo last week because of her size increase. And she was lethargic for the first few days, but I mean, it's just not even phasing her. So, it's just right now, it's just kind of how life is. And we don't treat her any different, although I get on her about drinking more water than the other two. Because she's got to flush all that stuff out of her system. Like today she has to take, what, 6 methotrexate pills, and you got to get that stuff out as fast as possible. So she's got to be on water for the next 3 days, pretty heavy. But mentally, that's a huge part of this entire equation, like fighting through cancer. Like, you literally have to fight. You can sit there and take it, but if you could have data on people that would sit there and just take their chemo, take their surgeries, instead of having the fortitude to mentally saying, no, I'm going to make myself get up and walk. I'm going to make myself eat. Like, I got this. And saying and keeping that, like, I am stronger than cancer all the time. Those are the survivors.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Have you, I finished, I kind of did it backwards, but Kelly Turner, PhD, she wrote two books, Radical Remissions and Radical Hope. And Radical Hope was her recent book. It's amazing book. Radical Remissions, also amazing book. It talks about, you know, these people's stories, and these 10 factors that can, and most of them, I think seven or eight of them are based on mental, like spiritual, positive affirmations. You know, there's a bunch of things. And then there's diet and exercise. Mm-hmm. Just these stories of these radical remissions of people just doing just a few of the, even just a few of these 10 factors is just a, you know, game changer.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And, you know, everybody is different. Everybody's body's different. Their cancers are different. We're all a very unique equation. And so what works for somebody may not work for others. So yeah, having, you know, that type of toolkit, having things published like that, yes. I mean, one of the biggest and best things you can do for yourself when battling through cancer is educate yourself. Like, you have to be your own advocate. Like with my daughter's situation, if we weren't an advocate for her and just counted on the hospital, who knows how many more weeks that would have gone by of her not being diagnosed. My wife, she was pissed. She was really on it about forcing me to get those tests done and stuff. You know, we both were, but you poke mama bear. She was really getting after it. So, educating yourself and, when you're in that position of fighting and you're fighting so hard, I mean, just like everybody else, sometimes you don't feel like you can battle anymore. Sometimes you do feel weak. And that's why it's important to have, those around you, loved ones, people that care about you, because it's okay that if you feel too tired to lean on them for support. I'm not too proud that, if I need help, I'll ask for it. I mean, there's one time that, I always just try to fight through everything, but my body gave out one night where, my wife came home from work and she found me, I think I was on the floor. And I rolled off the couch. I was just too weak to get up. And what happened is that I actually was going septic. I was septic like all day. And so it was messing with my mind. Like, she couldn't find the remote control. I like, for some reason, I put the remote control of the TV like in the garbage. Like, I was just doing stuff. And so she had to, literally pick me up. Luckily, I didn't weigh as much, but she had to pick me up, drag me to the car, and I passed out heading into Seattle on the freeway. And I remember it's a very specific feeling, and it's kind of like the end of a movie where it kind of closes in. Like, I was literally feeling myself die. I was dying.
Oh.
And so I looked at her while she was driving me, and I was like telling her how much I loved her, because I felt like those were the last words I was literally going to say.
She freaking out? I mean, she must have
been totally freaking out. And so I passed out in the car. I didn't remember anything after that. I woke up the next morning and in the hospital, and it was bags of blood everywhere. They had to give me transfusion after transfusion all over the night and the morning. And I woke up and I looked down at the end of my bed, and my mom was sitting there. So she drove to the hospital, and she's scared of blood. Like, she hates blood. And so this is kind of gives you like a little insight into my personality too. It's like, I looked at her. She wasn't looking at me. She was looking at the bags of blood hanging over my head and like staring at them. So I saw that. So I just, I reached up and I shook one of the bags around, splashed around the blood. And she's like,
oh, oh no.
I was totally messing with her. But, yeah, no, it's crazy. If you get weak and you got to really, if you don't feel strong enough that you could push through it, have your loved one be strong for you.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. What, you know, being a bodybuilder, fitness, working out, what do you, I know there's just a lot, you know, there's a lot of, cancer patients that just, you know, they didn't have any kind of exercise program prior to their diagnoses. And it just makes it that much harder. And, you know, I've talked to many where they're like, geez, you know, they can't fathom the idea to exercise because they don't know what it's like. Because they didn't really, maybe they did walk, you know, I mean, a lot of people walk, but, you know, that's it. So, you know, and maybe it wasn't even on a regular basis. I mean, sure, even I tell people, you know, even walking, just walk. I mean, that's going to do huge. But what do you suggest people start off if they really want to, you know, fight cancer and they really want to start exercising and they didn't before? What's your suggestion?
I mean, the first thing you have to do is like, you can exercise all you want, but if your diet's not right, first get that in check.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Oh, that's a good point.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's just like any type of engine. If you're putting the wrong fuel in there, it's not going to perform. So, yeah, definitely, you know, get your diet straight. But then as far as, you know, working out, getting some type of regimen, it's okay. Get a personal trainer. If you don't know what you're doing, research for yourself, or if you need the extra motivation, yeah, hire a trainer or just work out with a friend.
That's a good tip.
Yeah. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with doing that. But what's better than doing nothing is doing something, like you said. Walk. You know, get into a sport and like soccer. Like I played soccer right out of chemo. Like, you know, I had no eyebrows, no hair. No, I was like running down the soccer field playing soccer.
Wow.
People were like, what's Casper doing over here? So, I mean, it goes back to kind of that mental strength, right? Build it yourself. I mean, if you don't have experience in working out, you don't have to be a bodybuilder, really get into fitness, but you should do what's best for you. And, you know, everybody knows exercise is good for you. So do something. Okay. Diet straight and just do something. Kids have an unlimited amount of energy, apparently. Go run outside with them.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. No, that's awesome advice. You know, I tell people, you know, even, you know, start off with, because, you know, it's hard. Like, I remember, not that it gets easier, but your body adapts to chemo, like, after so many rounds. Like, I've had over 20 rounds. So, in the beginning, I remember I couldn't even, especially after my surgery. I mean, you have surgery, too, things like that. But, you know, you take a shower and you feel like you're going to pass out because, you know, moving your arms above your head, washing your hair and your body. And I remember I'd have to, after my shower, I'd still be a little bit wet. I couldn't even finish drying off. I'd have to lay down for like 2 hours. You know, but I just tell people, walk, you know, go an extra driveway, neighbor's driveway, you know, go down, you know, a little bit, just a little bit more. You know, now you got the phones, they track steps, you know, add, you know, couple, even if it's like 100 extra steps every day, you know, and you're going to get there. You know, the goal is, of course, you know, I try to do a lot of walking. I try to get 10,000 steps in, my wife and I, a day, even with her working. But, you know, I remember my goal was like, gosh, I think 1,000 steps. I don't know. It was really small. And I think that's important for people to know, you know, just start with little wins, slow goals, you know, and then just slowly increase, you know, but you got to monitor that. You got to monitor your steps. Cause if not, how do you know you're getting better? You know, unless, like I said, you know, maybe, you know, okay, I'm going to go down to this neighbor today. And
you know, tomorrow I'll go down one more house, you know, or two more houses or whatever. But yeah.
And that, and walking, like you say, walking's great. When you're fresh out of a surgery or chemo, one thing I do on the side is that I think I've coached probably maybe four or five people in the last few years, like through colon cancer, through leukemia, through stage four colon cancer, breast cancer, whole bunch of stuff. And so we just kind of bounce ideas off each other. You know, if they're having trouble with something, they'll just call me or text me, and I'll, you know, we'll talk about their chemo, talk about how they're feeling, talk about, like you said, like what can I do to kind of better my condition right now? And it's like, I've had a couple of them tell me, one of them had, it was colon cancer. So like downstairs, she's all messed up. She's got bad surgeries. I've had all this. I would have my colon removed. I can't really trust my body to walk and be able to make it back. So I was like, here, because you're outside your body weight that you're hauling around. I was like, do this. I was like, go get a cheap stationary bike. Because that way you're not holding your body weight up. You're sitting on a seat. And then you don't have to worry about not making it back because you're in one spot. And so not having that body weight, but still getting that cardio in, it helped out. Yeah. And now she's hiking up miles and miles of mountains. So,
oh, that's awesome. Yeah. Is there, this has been great. Great conversation. Do you have anything, you know, else for the audience that through your experience?
Not particularly. If you want to do another maybe a little small episode and get in some stories, I have some good ones. But it's kind of just going back to, you know, mentally how you overcome some things, or when you do feel too weak. I mean, stuff does happen, and it's about keeping a positive attitude, even when, you know, the ish hits the fan and you think that it can't get any worse. It might get worse, and you have to be mentally prepared for that.
Yeah, no, that's definitely good thoughts. Yeah. All right. Well, I want to say, thank you for coming on here, taking the time. Those that are listening, you can check out the YouTube podcast, and we're also on Google, Apple, and Spotify, Anchor, a bunch of others on www.cancerhopewithcoachsteve.com to get the links. And all right, Jimmy, thanks a lot.
Thanks, Steve.
We'll definitely have you back.
All right, man. You have a good one. Go lift heavy. Right,
see ya. Yeah.
From the Cancer Sucks Studios, that is a wrap. Check us out in future episodes of our podcast and be sure to subscribe. But before we go, just want to give a shout out to all the admirable and devoted caregivers out there. Until next time, stay strong. We got this.
Because every once in a while, the lion has to show the jackals.